Welcome back to another Ask GMBN Tech. Of course, this is the weekly Q&A show. You ask the questions, hopefully we give you the answers you need to answer your tech queries. Get your questions into the email address at the bottom of the screen just here, or you can add yours in the comments below. And let us know what you think of what's going on this show. So first up is from Scott Zeisman this week. Would it be feasible to put a reduced offset 29-inch fork in a bike designed around 27.5? Specifically, a 160 mm travel 29 fork in a 2017 Stump Jumper 650B. I'm thinking of upgrading the fork, but would like it to be future-proof. I guess so, if you're gonna get a 29-inch frame later on. A few years ago, that probably would have been a big no-no because the craze then was to have more offset on the fork to basically increase your low speed agility handling. But because offset is changing now on forks and there's more options there for you, I think you're gonna be quite close to this. So if I just drag up, I'm just gonna use RockShox as an example here because I do the Pike in 27.5 and 29-inch, very similar spec models. So looking on the chart on their site, I'm just gonna throw it on screen now, in fact. So we've got the Pike 27.5 and the 29 here. So offset options of the 27.5, you can get 37 mil and 46. With the 29, you can get 42 and 51. So if I was you and I was gonna put a 29-inch Pike onto your Specialized 650B, I'd go for the 42 mil offset because you're falling directly in the middle of the two offsets available for 27.5. So not too bad. And also by having that shorter offset, it does mean in future, if you want to have a nice long 29 aggressive bike, you've got that short offset, so it's going to feel really good. And then axle to crown height, which is quite important with this sort of thing. So the 27.5, again, these are both 160 mil, is 552, and on the 29, it's 561. So it's an 11 mil difference there. So it's not crazy, you know, it's like you will notice that slightly, but it's not the end of the world. You can get away with that. Perhaps run a touch more sag, and then a bit more low speed compression to just keep it from dipping too much. So I think you can get away with that now. It's not something you would have done a few years ago. And in fact, actually on my Scott Genius 900 tuned that I've got, that's actually got a 29-inch wheels on it and a 29-inch wheel fork on there, but it's also available in the 27.5 spec and it's basically the same and you just change the wheels out. So, and in fact, that's something Neil's done in a few other videos. So yeah, you can do that. So good luck. Next question is from Daylight Sensor. How can I get rid of Stiction? My Fox 34 isn't quite feeling the same as when I got it. Will a simple fork lower leg service help? And what can I do to keep it running smoothly on a daily basis? Okay, well, there's a few options here for you. So the fundamental key with any suspension fork to make it work well is keep it clean and lubricated. There are the two things that you have to have in order. It's a telescopic fork. If it's dry, it's not gonna work. If it's dirty, it's not gonna work. So firstly, keep your bike clean. Certainly all the moving parts, keep those clean if you really can't be bothered to clean the rest of it. And of course, take care of those seals, inspect the upper legs there, the stanchion tubes. If there's any gashes or cuts on them, they're gonna have a hindrance to other parts of the fork on the inside, like the bushes. That's gonna lead to the bushes getting scratched, they're never gonna slide, you can get worse wear on the inside. So there's a few maintenance tips I can offer. Obviously the first one and the major one is do a fork lower leg service. They're not that hard to do. You don't really need any special tools. You need a quality socket set, which is something that most mountain bikers will hopefully at least aspire to have, and they're definitely worth their money because you can use them on many household things, on a car or a motorbike if you've got something like that. So definitely worth investing in a socket set. You'll also need a syringe with measurements on it in cc or milliliters, so you can basically inject the correct amount of lubricating oil back into your forks. And you'll need some kind of mallet, and of course you will need the relevant oil for your fork. There's a lot of different options available on the market, so that's nothing to worry about there. So if you have those things, you can do one of these services at home yourself. Of course, you can go a bit further and change seals and do stuff like that, in which case you might not want to do that yourself if you're not confident. And of course, when you're doing a fork lower leg service, you do have the option of popping the seals out and replacing those with fresh seals. Now, fork seals are really quite simple things. They've got a little garter spring around the top to keep that seal on the stanchion tube. The seal itself is really just a lump of rubber. There's not too much to it, but of course you get different quality ones available on the market. Underneath the seal, you get this little foam ring. Now, that foam ring is one of the key parts in your fork working well. If that's dry, basically you've got a dry seal sliding up and down on that stanchion tube. It's never gonna feel that good. So you can do a real quick, easy, get your fork feeling good by popping that garter spring off. Use like a really small screwdriver, but be super careful you don't scratch that stanchion tube. Get the end of a cable tight and poke it down between the stanchion tube and that seal and drop some fork oil around the top there. Do it all the way around and put the garter spring back on. Compress your fork a few times and you'll find that some sort of gunk will come out, and it's basically that oil will draw out any horrible stuff. So of course there's the fork lower leg service, there's the little service you can do on the seals, or if you want to combine both of them in actually what's really quick and easy and something I do every few months, do the seals up top like I just said, and then using your socket set, undo the foot nuts on the bottom of both legs. Don't unscrew them all the way. Use the socket set combined with a mallet to just tap them hard and shock them. The purpose of that is the rods on the inside will free from the outer legs. You can then, making sure you've got something to catch it underneath, just slide those legs out a little bit and hopefully dirty oil that's in your fork will drain out. Then all you've got to do is replace that oil using the syringe and the oil supply you have with some fresh oil to the correct amount that your manufacturer states, put the nuts back on, and then basically give it all a good wipe and you're good to go. And that works really well, and that does keep your forks working so slick. So the more you can do to keep them clean and lubricated, the better. Next up is geometry based, and that's from Ethan Rose. I just got myself a brand new 2019 Giant Trance Advanced One. Man, that's a seriously nice bit of kit. And I'm looking to slacken the head angle a bit. I've looked at some angled headsets, but no one seems to make one that will fit an integrated headset. Is there another way I can slacken off the head angle? Well, firstly, you can do it with some options. And actually, I don't know what the head tube is like on your particular bike. You can go on the Cane Creek website and use their calculator, putting in the dimensions and stuff of your head tube and all that sort of stuff, and it will tell you if something will fit. Not necessarily have to use their brand. It gives you the part numbers like a ZS. It tells you the exact size of the bearings and stuff to fit in there, and of course there are other options available on the market, but of course that's not always the case. You might be lucky there. I think your only option is offset shock bushings. So I'm just going to throw you to this site. It's on the screen at the moment, and if you look at this shot you can see where the bushings go into the shock eyelets. They're literally, you can have those, the bolt will go in offset and it would just buy you a little bit of space just to slacken off the head angle a little bit. They're not quite, you haven't got as many options with them as you do with slacking off the headset using angled cups, but it'll definitely slacken it a little bit. As an upside, it will also lower your BB a tiny bit, but as a downside, it will slacken your seat angle very slightly because it basically tips your whole triangle back. Whereas when you put a slack fork or you slacken the headset off, you actually steepen your seat angle because the frame will drop slightly as the fork goes like that. But that's really your only option. As far as changing the geometry goes, you could put a slightly smaller rear tire and a slightly bigger front tire on. That would do it. Or you could bump up your fork travel by 10 millimeters. Barely enough to notice, but that 10 millimeters can buy you like half a degree, I think it is, works out. So definitely worth contemplating that. So that's your options really, but solid bike choice there. And at the end of the day, you can just get used to it. It might feel like you want it slacker at first, but the more you get used to something, the more you learn to love it. Buying choice here from Dragomir Stefanov. Doddy, I'm planning to buy a new bike next season, and as a big fan of the YT Capra and a current owner of the older generation 2015 model, I'm now wondering whether to stay at 27.5 or go 29 when looking at 2019 model. What got my attention is that when looking at the Fox equipped models, they tend to use the X2 on the 27.5, so that's the downhill shock basically, and the DPX2 on the 29. Yeah, okay, so that's more like a trail focused shock. In all the reviews I've read, people describe the 29 as more nervous and responsive and the 27.5 as more plush and ground hugging. For me, this is due to different shocks you use. Yeah, all right, that figures, I see what you're thinking. What is the reason for this choice according to you? Is it due to shock sizes and availability, or I've always wanted to have an X2, so a Capra 29er with an X2 could be phenomenal if possible. Well, firstly, it is possible to have that because on the top model, I think it's the Pro Race, they have an X2 on there, so it clearly is possible. The only thing I can think, what these reviewers have said, is that the bike's not set up quite right. Don't get me wrong, an X2 is seriously planted and can feel very different to a DPX2, but you can definitely set up a DPX2 to feel very, very similar. Now, don't forget as well that smaller size wheel bikes do feel more agile, but as a result of that, they need taming a little bit more. So an X2 is really favorable on that. Whereas a bigger wheel, 29 inch wheel bike, they tend to handle the rough a little bit better. So you can get away with a lighter shock that's a bit more efficient. So I think perhaps there's one of the reasons there that that shock is spec'd on that bike, because bigger wheels, bigger tires, etc., they are heavier, fact. And if you're gonna have a bike that's that heavy, you need a little bit of help in other areas. And generally, because of those bigger wheels, they allow you to go faster, basically. You can get away with having less in other areas. So that's really what I can think that YT have done. But the DPX2 is a fantastic shock, so certainly don't get put off by that. But as I said, you can make an X2 fit on that bike. So if you want the ultimate in plow through anything or whatever speed you fancy, that's probably the combination you're looking at. Of course, the Pro Race model with that X2 on is quite a lot more expensive than I'm guessing the models you're looking at, because there's other cheaper models with their Fox Elite forks and stuff on there with that X2. But knowing what YT are like, I'm fairly sure you might be able to get that changed out. So it's definitely worth contacting them. Of course, their bikes do sell out quickly and then have to get them back in stock again. So you might luck out on that. And also, I did notice on the website that specs can change between models, despite what's advertised. And I'm guessing, you know, if they have to knock out a run of bikes and the OEM spec hasn't got enough left in a particular model, they'll do like for like of the nearest possible. So make sure you check on those sort of things. But if I was you, I would probably opt for the DPX2. Knowing how well 29er bikes ride in the rough, I think you can get away with less in other areas, but if you really think the X2 is what you need, go for it. Okay, next up is from Callum, I guess, maybe. My cassette can come off my wheel, but the Freehub body is stuck inside, right? Okay, yeah, I've seen this. How can I get the Freehub body off the cassette? I'm trying to replace the ratchet on my DT Swiss hub. It sounds to me like your particular cassette is probably a Shimano pattern cassette, has ground its way into that Freehub body itself. So I'm just throwing you to one on the screen here just to show you what that looks like when it happens. So some cassettes are made up of multiple parts, various different spacers and washers in between the actual sprockets. And any one of those particular sprockets, if you put enough torque on it and the cassette body itself is made of a slightly softer material, they can cut their way in slightly. And if that happens, it's not gonna slide off when it's supposed to slide off. And I have seen, in some cases, I've seen these manage to spin all the way through, with some four cross racers in the past I've noticed to be running aluminium bodies, which of course is a very soft material. So if that's happening to you, you might want to look at getting a steel body. But more importantly, for getting it off, basically what you need to do is get it all back on the bike in the first place, and then work out why it just popped off so easily. So there's usually two things that hold those on. So one of which will be the seal at the top. If that's popped out, it's gonna be hard to get that back in. And the other one is the actual washer or spacer on the end of the axle there that pushes directly on. So if that's popped off, that can actually hold it back on, if you get me. So you need to use your chain whip and undo the lock ring on the outside there. And basically maintaining using that chain whip, you're gonna have to tap each individual sprocket to just shock it to make sure it comes loose from that cassette body. In fact, I'm gonna do a video on doing this, because it is a problem that does happen to some people, and it's pretty annoying when it does happen. Try that and check back soon, because I'll do a little how-to on that. Next up's from Bjorn46. One question, is the lock ring on a GX Eagle the same as with Shimano? Reason for asking, I have a new bike and hadn't needed to remove the cassette yet, and I have a brand new Shimano lock ring tool lying around. My bike's got Eagle GX. Yeah, the lock ring tool is exactly the same, basically. So there are some various different options out there. This one is designed to slide into a through axle, so that's like the latest style. And actually, these grip better than anything, but you would notice that with that new feature. But if you've got anything that looks like either of these, they're gonna fit. So no worries on that. Continue to take your cassette off in the same way. You'll still need to use a chain whip to hold it in place while you undo the effective lock ring there. So good luck with that, and continue using your tools. And finally is from Cooper Ondersmar. Why do bikes that use a pinion gearbox always have a twist shifter instead of a traditional trigger shifter? So it's a bit annoying, actually. I'm not the biggest fan of twist shifters, but because of the fact that pinion gearbox uses a twin cable system, they had to develop the shifter this way. It's too complicated at this stage for them to master an under the bar trigger shifter. I'm sure that might happen at some point in the future, but they've just brought out a brand new version of the twist shifter, which is way neater. So For the moment, this is how their existing one looks, and it's got the cables that fire straight out from the bars. And of course, cable routing is not that pretty with it. And of course, the shifter, I mean, the whole pinion system is incredible, really. I think it's just a masterpiece of design, but the shifter's quite clunky compared to how neat and well everything else works. And now this is their new shifter. So note how much neater the actual barrel looks. I haven't used it, but I'm betting it's got way shorter throw on it and it feels a lot punchier in use. And the cables neatly push out underneath the bars there, so you can follow a nice cable routing, follow along with every other part of the cable routing on your bike to tidy things up. So they're definitely developing stuff, but really the reason for that is they're cramming two cables in there, and that's because of the series of gears on the inside, the way they have to work. There's your answer. So there you go, that's the end of another weekly Ask GMBN Tech session. If you've got any questions, don't forget to email us or get them in those comments underneath. And for a couple more tech-related videos, click down here if you want to see all about the BMC 4-stroke. That's the XC World Cup bike. Basically, it's got geometry of like a 4-cross bike. This thing is amazing. And click down here if you want to see 5 more common questions. So we do this quite often where we get a bunch of questions that a lot of you ask, and I'm going to show you how to fix those things. So click down there for that. As always, don't forget to give us a thumbs up, and if you've not already subscribed, please do so.